Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Boundary Waters by William Kent Krueger, narrated by David Chandler, and directed by Erica Jensen.
Chapter 1. He was a tough old bird, the Redskin. Milwaukee allowed himself the dangerous luxury of admiring the old man fully. He was smart, too, but way too trusting. And that, Milwaukee knew, was his undoing. Milwaukee turned away from the Indian and addressed the two men sitting by the campfire.
I can go on, but the Indian's not going to talk. I can almost guarantee it.
I thought you guaranteed results, the nervous one said.
I'll get you what you want, only it won't be coming from him.
Go on, the nervous man said. He squeezed his hands together and jerked his head toward the Indian.
Do it. Your ball game.
Milwaukee stepped to the campfire and pulled a long beechwood stick from the coals. The end of the stick glowed red, and two licks of flame leaped out on either side like the horns of a devil held in Milwaukee's hand. The old Indian hung spread-eagled between two small birch trees, secured to the slender trunks by nylon cords bound about his wrists and ankles. He was naked, although the night was cool and damp enough to make his blood steam as it flowed down his skin over the washboard of his ribs. Behind him, darkness closed like a black curtain over the rest of the deep woods. The campfire lit the old man as if he were a single actor in a command performance.
Or, Milwaukee thought as he approached with the burning stick, a puppet who'd broken his strings.
Milwaukee grasped the long gray hair and lifted the old man's head. The eyes flickered open. Dark almond eyes, resigned but not broken.
See?
Milwaukee brought the angry glow inches from his face.
Your eyes will bubble, just like stew. First one, then the other.
The almond eyes looked steadily at Milwaukee, as if there were not at all a flame between them.
Just tell us how to get to the woman, and I won't hurt you anymore.
Milwaukee offered. Although he meant it, he'd have been disappointed in the Indian if he broke, for he felt a rare companionship with the old man that had nothing to do with the business between them, but was something in their spirits, something indomitable, something the nervous man by the fire would never understand. Milwaukee knew about the old man, knew how he was strong deep down, knew the information they were after would never come from him. In the end, the living would still be ignorant, and the important answers, as always, would reside with the dead. The second man at the campfire spoke.
Gone soft?
He was a huge man with a shaved head. He lit a fat Cuban cigar with a stick much like Milwaukee held, and he smiled. He smiled because next to himself, Milwaukee was the hardest man he knew, and like Milwaukee, he tolerated the nervous man only because of the money.
Go on, the nervous man commanded. Do it, for Christ's sake. I've got to know where she is.
Milwaukee looked deeply into the eyes of the old man, into his soul, and wordlessly he spoke. Then he tipped the stick. The reflection of the fire filled the old man's right eye. The old man didn't blink. Chapter 2. Wendell was 3 days late. The woman's anger had passed and worry had set in, a heavy stone on all her thinking. Wendell Two Knives had never been late before. In the early afternoon, she stepped from the cabin and walked along the little creek down to the lake. Like many of the lakes in the Boundary Waters, it was small, long and narrow, 100 yards wide and little more than half a mile long. It lay in a deep trough between two ridges of gray stone capped with aspen. A week ago, the aspen leaves had been yellow gold, every tree like a match head struck to flame. Now the branches were mostly bare. The scattered leaves that still hung there shivered in the wind over the ridges, and one by one they fell away. The water of the lake was very still. Even on days when the wind whipped the aspen trees high above, the narrow slit of water remained calm. Wendell told her the Anishinaabe called the lake Nikidin, which meant vulva. She often looked at that narrow stretch of calm whose surface reflected mostly heaven and smiled at the sensibility of Wendell's people. But now she stared down the gray rocky corridor with concern. Where the hell was Wendell? He'd come 10 days before, bringing her, as always, food and the batteries for her precious tape recorder. He told her his next visit should be his last. It was time for her to go. He said if she stayed much longer, she risked a winter storm, and then it would be hell getting out. She'd looked at the aspen, whose leaves had only just turned, and at the clear blue sky, and at the calm water of the lake that was warm enough still for a brief swim in the afternoons, and she'd laughed. Snow, she'd questioned. But it's absolutely beautiful, Wendell. These woods, he'd cautioned darkly. This country. No man can ever say for sure. Better to be safe. She was almost finished anyway with the work that had brought her to that secret place, and so she agreed. On his arrival the following week, she would be ready. She gave him a letter to mail, as she always did, and watched his canoe glide away, silver ripples fanning out behind him like the tail feathers of a great bird. Now there were thin, white clouds high up in the blue, and along the ridges a constant wind that she couldn't feel, but could plainly see in the waving of the aspens. She pulled her jean jacket close around her and shivered, wondering if the smell in the air, something sharp and clean, was the approach of the winter storm Wendell feared. For the first time since she'd come to that lost lake and its old cabin, she was tight with a sense of urgency. She turned and followed the thread of the creek back through a stand of red pine that hid the cabin. From its place on the rough-hewn wood table near the pot-bellied stove, she took her tape recorder and turned it on. There was a red light in the lower right-hand corner that blinked whenever the batteries were getting low. The red light was blinking. She lifted the recorder near her mouth and held it in both hands. Saturday, the 15th of October. Wendell still hasn't come. She sat in the empty cabin a moment, aware of the silence of the afternoon, terribly aware of her aloneness in the great wilderness. He said he would be here, and he's the only man who's ever kept his promises to me, she said into the recorder. Something's wrong, I know it. Something's happened to him. The red light blinked off, but she left the recorder on, not knowing if it captured at all her final confession. Jesus Christ, I'm scared. Chapter 3. Cork was breathing hard and feeling great. He'd been running for an hour and he was nearing home. Each stride landed on a mat of fallen leaves and each breath filled him with the dusty smell of a long, dry autumn. He kept to a gravel road that paralleled the Burlington Northern tracks. The tracks ran through the town of Aurora, Minnesota, and in doing so, shadowed Iron Lake. In the late afternoon of that mid-October day, the lake was dead calm, a perfect mirror of a perfect sky, blue and piercing. The trees along the shoreline were ablaze, bursts of orange and russet that exploded again on the still surface of the water. In boats here and there, solitary fishermen cast their lines, shattering the mirror in brief silver splashes. Cork cleared a small stand of gold-leafed birch and aspen that surrounded the ruins of an old foundry, and Sam's place came into view. It was a Quonset hut, Second World War vintage, that had been turned into a burger stand by an old friend of Cork's named Sam Winter Moon. The front of the hut was decorated with pictures of burgers, Sam's Super Deluxe especially, and fries and ice cream cones. Cork lived in the back part of the long hut. He'd inherited the place a couple of years earlier after his old friend was killed by a scared little man with a big rifle. As he crossed the tracks, he heard a scream come from Sam's place. He kicked into a sprint and ran. Behind the sliding screen of the serving window, his 12-year-old daughter Annie jumped up and down wildly. "What is it?" Cork called. Annie ripped the headphones of her Walkman from her ears. "Notre Dame just scored, yes!" She was tall, athletic, and very freckled. She had red hair kept austerely short. At the moment, she wore blue jean cutoffs and a t-shirt with colorful block letters that spelled out, "Love knows no color." Her enthusiasm for Notre Dame was long-standing and legendary. Annie was more Catholic than the Pope. There were times when Cork envied her profound and simplistic faith, because it wasn't a thing he shared anymore. On that afternoon, however, the perfection of the day had given him a sense of spiritual peace as profound as anything that came of Christian prayer. "Straight is my path, straight is my mind, straight is my heart, straight is my speech. Kind will I be to my brothers and sisters, kind will I be to beast and bird." He remembered the words of the drum song old Henry Malou sang. That seemed to just about cover it all as far as Cork was concerned. "Where's Jenny?" Cork asked. He'd left his two daughters in charge while he went for his daily run. Annie had stayed at her post. Jenny was nowhere to be seen.
"She said it was too slow and she went for a walk."
Cork could tell his daughter disapproved. To Annie, authority was important. Rules existed for good reason, and any breach in protocol was always to be viewed with a disapproving eye. She was a wonderful Catholic. "Has it been slow?"
"Dead," Annie admitted.
"Good for you, though," Cork observed. "You've been able to listen to the game without being bothered." Annie grinned and put her headphones back on. "I'm going to shower," Cork said. The salt in his sweat was crystallizing, and he felt gritty. Before he could move, a delivery truck bounced over the railroad tracks, kicked up dust along the unpaved road to Sam's place, and pulled to a stop a half dozen yards from where Cork stood. The truck was painted gold and bore a big green shamrock and green lettering that read, "Cloverleaf Potato Chips." Charlie Alto, a large, pot-bellied Finn, stepped out, wearing a gold shirt and gold cap, both of which bore the same green shamrock logo as the truck.
"What do you say, Dare O'Connor? Training for another marathon, looks like."
"One a year is enough, Charlie," Cork said. He'd run in the Twin Cities Marathon only a week before, his first. He hadn't broken 4 hours, but he'd finished, and that had been just fine.
"What are you doing out here? Monday's your usual drop by."
"On my way in from Tower. Figured I might as well save myself a trip. How's business?"
"Been good. Slow at the moment, but the best fall I've ever seen."
Charlie opened the back of his truck where boxes of potato chips were stacked.
"Gonna pay for it," Charlie said. "Snow by Halloween, betcha. Bunch of it. And one tough bastard of a winter after that."
He pulled down two boxes, one regular, one barbecue.
"What makes you think so, Charlie?"
"I was just shooting the breeze with old Adolph Penske. Over to Two Corners, you know. Runs a trap line up on Rust Creek. Says he ain't seen coats on the muskrats in years like what they're getting now."
"Means good ice fishing," Cork considered.
"Yeah," the Finn said, nodding. With a look of envy, he eyed the nearest fisherman on the lake.
"Been a busy year. Ain't had near enough time in my boat. Like to be on the lake right now, fishing like that son of a gun out there."
He watched a few moments more. "Well," he decided, "maybe not like him." Cork glanced at the fisherman on Iron Lake.
"Why not?"
"Hell, look at him. Don't know squat about fishing. Using a surface lure, looks like. You know, a topwater plug. Supposed to hop the dang thing across the surface, fool them northerns into believing it's a frog or something. That guy's letting it sink like it was live bait. Ain't no fish dumb enough to hit on that."
He shook his head in misery.
"God save us from city folk.
Come to think of it, Cork said. He's been out there the whole day, and I'll be damned if I've seen him pull anything in. Charlie handed Cork a pen and a receipt to sign for the chips. Now you tell me why any fisherman, even a goddamn dumb one, would stay in the same place the whole day if the fish ain't biting. Another scream burst from Sam's place. Dat Annie? Charlie asked. She's listening to the Notre Dame game. They must have scored again. Still planning on being a nun? Either that, Cork said, signing for the boxes of chips before Charlie took off, or the first female quarterback for the Fighting Irish. Sam's place stood on the outskirts of Aurora, hard on the shore of Iron Lake. Sam Wintermoon had built a simple, sturdy dock where the pleasure boats that supplied most of his business tied up. Directly north was the Bear Paw Brewery, separated from Cork's property by a tall chain-link fence. Cork didn't much like the brewery, but, in fact, it had been there longer than Sam's place, and in the hard economic times before the Iron Lake Ojibwe built the Chippewa Grand Casino, it had sustained lots of households in Aurora. So what could he say? Cork eyed the nearly empty lake as he passed the chip boxes through the window to Annie. What do you say we call it a day, he suggested.
What about Jenny?
She knows the way home.
We're supposed to stay open another hour, she reminded him. What if someone comes expecting to eat and we're not here?
What's the use of being the boss if you can't break the rules once in a while? Cork told her. Let's shut her down. Annie didn't move. She nodded toward a car pulling into the place vacated by Charlie Alto's chip truck.
See? A customer.
The car was a rental, a black Lexus. The man who got out pulled off his sunglasses and walked their way.
Corcoran O'Connor?
He was a big man, late 50s, with thin hair going gray and a thin, graying mustache. He had a long, jowled face, not especially handsome, that reminded Cork a little of a bloodhound. I'm O'Connor. The man was dressed in an expensive leather jacket, light brown suede like doe hide with a rust-colored turtleneck underneath. His clothes were the color and weight for a normal fall day, too warm for that day, but the long, hot autumn had them all surprised. Despite the quality of his clothing, he seemed, maybe because of his easy, lumbering gait, like a man who'd be at home staring at the rump of a mule all day while he wrestled a plow through red clay.
My name's William Ray,
he offered Cork his hand. I know, Cork said. Arkansas Willie.
You remember me?
The man sounded pleased. Even without the bibbles and the banjo, I'd recognize you anywhere. Annie, Cork turned, let me introduce William Ray, better known as Arkansas Willie. Mr. Ray, my daughter Annie.
Well, hey there, little darling. How you all doing?
His voice was slow, like his gait, and all his words seemed to be gifted with an extra syllable. It was a voice Cork remembered well. 20 years ago, every Saturday night, Cork had managed to clear his schedule to be in front of the television for Skunk Holler Hoedown. The program was syndicated, a country music review full of guitars and fiddles and banjos and enough corn to feed a hungry herd of cattle, broadcast from the Grand Ole Opry in Nashville, and hosted by Arkansas Willie Ray and his wife, a woman named Marae Grand.
Sugar, I wonder if you'd pour me a little water there?
Ray asked Annie.
My throat's dry as a Skunk Hollow hooch jug come Sunday morning.
Still entertaining, Mr. Ray? Cork asked.
Might as well call me Willie. Most folks do. Nope, don't even do charities anymore. I put away my bibbles and banjo after Marae died.
The hurt was old, but the man's voice carried a fresh sadness. He put his hands in his pockets and explored the inside of his cheek with his tongue.
I have a recording company now, he said, brightening. Ozark Records, biggest country label in the business. The Blacklock Brothers, Felicity Green, Rhett Taylor, they're all on Ozark.
Here you are, Mr. Ray.
Annie passed a big sweetheart cup full of water and ice through the window.
I thank you kindly, honey bunch.
Up here for the color? Annie asked.
No, actually, I'm up here to see your daddy.
He turned to Cork.
Is there a place we can talk for a few minutes? In private?
Mr. Ray and I are going to walk a bit, Annie. Hold down the fort?
Sure, Dad.
They strolled to the end of the dock where sunnies swam in the shallows. The water was rust-colored from the heavy concentration of iron ore in the earth. Ray looked out over the lake, smiling appreciatively.
I only made it up here once, when Grand View was being built. It's every bit as beautiful as I remember it. Easy to see why Marae loved it like she did.
He set his water cup down on the bleached planking of the old dock and pulled a compact disc from the pocket of his leather jacket. He handed the disc to Cork.
Know who that is?
Shiloh, Cork said, remarking on the woman whose picture filled the cover. She was a slight woman, young, very pretty, with smooth black hair like a waterfall down her back all the way to her butt. One of Annie's favorites.
My daughter, Ray said. And Marae's.
I know. Ray regarded him earnestly out of that long hound dog face.
Do you know where she is?
Cork was caught off guard.
I beg your pardon?
If you do, Ray rushed on, I only need to know she's all right, that's all.
Willie, I'm afraid I don't have the slightest idea what you're talking about. Ray's big shoulders dropped. His face glistened with sweat. He shrugged out of his jacket and hung it on one of the posts that anchored the dock. He wiped his forehead with the back of his hand.
I gotta sit down.
Cork hooked his foot around the leg of a small stool he sometimes used when fishing from the dock and nudged it toward Ray, who sat down heavily. The man picked up a golden leaf that had blown onto the dock and idly tore it into little bits as he spoke.
Marae sometimes talked about the people back here, the people she grew up with. When she talked about you, she called you Nishima.
Means little brother, Cork said.
I guess she thought a lot of you.
I'm flattered, but I don't understand what that has to do with Shiloh.
The deal is this. My daughter's been missing for a while. Several weeks ago, she canceled all her engagements and dropped from sight. The tabloids are having a field day.
I know. I've seen them.
She's been writing me a letter every week. All the letters have been postmarked from Aurora. 2 weeks ago, the letters stopped.
Maybe she just got tired of writing.
If I thought that, I wouldn't be here.
She didn't say in her letters where she is?
Nothing specific. She didn't want anyone to know. She was here for something she called, I don't remember exactly. It sounded like misery.
Misery. Cork pondered that a moment. Mizewaya, maybe? It means all of something, the whole shebang. Does that make sense to you?
Not to me,
Ray shrugged.
Anyway, she talked about a cabin way out in the boundary waters. And she said she'd been guided there by an old friend of her mother, someone with Indian blood. That's why I thought it might be you.
I don't know anything about your daughter, Willie. What's your worry, exactly?
See, Shiloh's been under the care of a psychiatrist for a while. Drug abuse, depression. She tried suicide before. When the letters stopped,
he looked up at Cork like a man staring out of a deep well, hoping to be thrown a rope.
All I want is to know for sure my daughter's alive and okay. Will you help me?
How?
You could start by helping me find the man who guided her in. That's all.
Out on the lake, a motor kicked in. A couple of hundred yards from shore, a boat began to troll, gently wrinkling the perfect surface, leaving a wake that rolled away from it like a blue silk flag on a listless breeze. Cork shook his head.
A man with Indian blood? That could be a pretty tall order. Half this county has some Anishinaabe blood in them. I'm not the sheriff around here anymore. I just run a hamburger stand. I think you should go to the proper authorities on this one.
I can't take a chance on publicity,
Ray said, looking stricken.
If word got out that Shiloh was somewhere up in the woods here, those tabloid reporters would be on this place like dogs on a ham bone. No telling who'd be out there looking for her. Shiloh gets more than her share of letters from psychotic fans. My God, it would be like open season.
He threw away the remains of the leaf he'd torn apart. The broken pieces drifted away, shuddering as the sunnies nibbled at them, fooled by their size and color and sudden appearance which mimicked insects lighting on the water.
Look, I know you don't really know me, but I'm not just asking this for me.
If Moray was still alive, she'd be the one doing the asking.
Cork rubbed his arms to generate some heat. He could feel in his legs and shoulders the stiffness from his run.
I have a business, Will, and I don't do police work anymore.
Ray stood up and desperately took hold of Cork's shoulder.
Help me find her, and I'll pay you enough to retire tomorrow.
I don't know if I could help you find her.
Will you try? Please?
Behind the serving window, Annie screamed. Cork looked her way. The scream had been one of excitement, not terror, but it made him think. What if Annie were the one out there, or Jenny, one of his own? He'd be desperate too. Circumstance alone had saddled Willie Ray with this burden. It wasn't Cork's business or responsibility, but he said,
"You say you got a letter every week, and all were postmarked Aurora?"
"Yes. There wasn't much in them that I could see would be any help, but maybe there's something you all would pick up on. You're welcome to look at them. The back of my cabin."
"Where are you staying?"
"Grandview."
"Grandview? Been a long time."
"I know. Told myself lots of times to get shut of the place. It's a past. But Moray, she loved it so. I just couldn't bring myself to let it go."
Cork said, "I'll stop by this evening. I want to shower and eat first. Say 7 o'clock?
"Thanks."
Ray grabbed his hand and pumped it hard.
"Thank you kindly."
After Arkansas Willie had driven away, Cork returned to the serving window.
"How's the game going?"
"Over! Notre Dame won!" Annie gave a big victory grin.
"What do you say? Think we can shut her down?"
Annie started about the business of closing. "What did Mr. Ray want?"
"A little help finding something. I'll take care of it."
"He talks like a hillbilly, is he?"
"Don't let him fool you, Annie. I'm sure he's made a fortune sounding like a hayseed."
Cork cleaned up outside, pulling the big trash bag from the barrel by the picnic table and hauling it to the dumpster near the road. As he headed back toward Sam's place, he noticed that the fisherman also appeared to be packing up his gear and calling it a day. Cork considered him a moment. Charlie Alto's question had been a good one. Why would a fisherman, even a goddamn dumb one, spend the whole day in a place where the fish weren't biting? Chapter 4. Although it was the best fall anyone could remember in years, the town of Aurora was prepared for the worst. In that far north country, winter was always on the mind. Cords of split wood were stacked against garages and porch walls. In the evening, the air was heavily scented with the smell of wood smoke. A sign in the window of Mayfair's clothing on Center Street warned, "Don't be fooled, it's coming. Winter coats, 20% off." Rows of snowblowers flanked the bin of Halloween pumpkins outside Nelson's Hardware Hank. Heading down Oak Street as he took Annie home, Cork spotted Ned Overby up on his extension ladder, affixing Christmas lights to his gutters. Cork pulled onto Gooseberry Lane and into the driveway of the two-story house where he'd been raised. Stepping from his Bronco, he considered the porch swing, empty now in the shadows. For Cork, the approach of winter wasn't palpable until he'd taken down the swing and stored it in the garage for the season. He stood on the lawn, considered the brilliant red of the maple tree against the clear blue afternoon sky, and took in with long, deep breaths the warm autumn air. He decided that despite Charlie Alto's warning of heavy snow by Halloween, it would still be a long time before he put that swing away. Annie sprinted through the side door into the kitchen. Cork followed and found himself in a house that, except for Annie and him, seemed empty. He hadn't lived in the house on Gooseberry Lane for nearly a year and a half.
He'd grown used to living alone at Sam's place, but it wasn't the way he'd choose to live if the choice were his alone. Annie had the television on, tuned to highlights of the Notre Dame game. Cork passed through the living room and called up the stairs. "Anybody home?" "In here," Joe's voice came from her office just down the hall. Nancy Jo O'Connor sat at her desk, paper spread out before her, a pen in her hand. She was dressed in faded jeans and a denim blouse with the sleeves rolled up to her elbows. Her blonde hair was short and a little disheveled, as if she'd run her hand through it in frustration. She wore her glasses, which made her ice blue eyes big and startled looking. She smiled at her husband as he stepped in. Joe wasn't alone. Near her at the desk sat a tall man with the black hair, almond eyes, and light bronze skin of the Ojibwe Anishinaabe. He sat back a little from Joe as soon as Cork stepped in. Joe took off her glasses. Her eyes grew smaller, but no less blue. "I didn't expect anyone for a while." "No customers," Cork explained. "We shut down early." He nodded toward the tall Shinub. "Afternoon, Dan." "Hello, Cork." Daniel Wadena offered him a cordial smile. Wadena was the manager of the Chippewa Grand Casino, an enterprise operated by the Iron Lake Band of Ojibwe. He wore a red t-shirt that read, "Cash in at the Grand," across the front in black letters. "Business on Saturday?" Cork shook his head. "We're trying to get the contracts together so we can actually break ground for the casino hotel before winter sets in," Joe said. She'd been counsel for Iron Lake Anishinaabe for years. "Better hurry," Cork cautioned. "Word is, snow by Halloween." Wadena glanced outside. "Did you get that from the weather service?" "Muskrats," Cork said. Joe stretched. "I think that's it for me today, Dan." "A good day's work," Wadena concluded, and stood up. He carefully placed a number of documents in his briefcase, clicked the latch, and stepped away from the desk. "Monday?" he asked Joe. "I'm in court most of the morning." "After lunch?" she suggested. "Fine. I'll see myself out." "Take her easy, Cork," he said as he exited. Cork walked to the chair Wadena had vacated and plopped himself down. He watched Joe as she arranged the papers on her desk. "He's taken with you, you know." "I know." She opened her desk drawer and put away her pens. "I don't encourage him." "He's what I believe they call a catch." "Like a mackerel?" She looked at him directly. "The last thing I need in my life right now is another man." She put her glasses back on and made a notation on her calendar. Cork heard the front door open, and a moment later, his sister-in-law Rose slumped against the doorway of Joe's office, a small sack of groceries in her arms. Rose was a large, plain woman with hair the color of road dust and a heart as big as Gibraltar. She was unlike her sister Joe in almost all respects, except for the way she loved the children. She'd helped raise them from the beginning, and although they hadn't come from her body, a great deal of who they were had been born from the goodness of her spirit. Cork had never felt anything but love and an overwhelming gratitude toward the lumbering woman who stood puffing in the doorway. "Stevie ran practically the whole way," Rose said, breathless. Beads of sweat popped out on her forehead and temples and followed the plump contours of her cheeks. "This weather has him crazy." "Where is he?" Cork asked. "I'm right here," 6-year-old Stevie squeezed through the doorway past his aunt. Of Cork's children, Stevie most clearly carried the signs of his Anishinaabe heritage. His hair was straight and dark, his cheeks high, his eyes thick-lidded. He smiled eagerly at his father. "Annie said she'd play some football with me if you will." "Will you?" "Sure," Cork agreed. "For a little while. Meet you guys in the front yard." Stevie cried, "Yippee," and vanished back through the doorway. "I'm going to start dinner," Rose said. "Cork, will you join us? Just burgers on the grill." "Thanks, but I haven't had a chance to shower after my run this afternoon. I'll just toss the ball a bit with Stevie, then head back to Sam's place and get myself cleaned up." "We've rented a video," she tried again.
The Lion King. Stevie's favorite, you know.
He glanced at Joe, who gave him a nod. Maybe I'll make it for that, but don't wait for me. Rose turned and carried the groceries away.
Didn't Jenny come home with you? Joe asked.
Cork shook his head. Went for a walk. Never came back.
She went to see Sean, I'll bet, Joe said.
Speak of the devil.
Joe's eyes shifted to the window where Cork's attention had been drawn. Jenny and a teenaged boy had stepped into the backyard from the alley. They stood together near the end of the lilac hedge, and they kissed. Cork moved closer to the screen.
Don't spy, Joe said. I'm not spying. I'm assessing the quality of their relationship.
Every year, Jenny grew to resemble her mother more. Slender, blonde, bright, independent. At 14, she'd been keen on piercing her nose, had dyed her hair purple, and had chosen most of her wardrobe from the Salvation Army. Now, almost 16, she spoke no more of nose studs, had washed the dye from her hair, and bought her clothing at mall shops. She'd stumbled onto the diary of Aeneas Nin, and was saving all her money to move to Paris just as soon as she graduated from high school. Joe said she'd change her mind about that, but Cork wasn't so sure. Like Joe, once Jenny had decided a thing, it was as good as done. The boy with her, Sean Murray, was a tall, lanky kid with long black hair and a lot of dark fuzz along his cheekbones. Whenever Cork saw him, Sean was dressed entirely in black.
What does she see in him? Cork asked. He looks like a burned matchstick.
He writes her poetry. And he's a nice kid. Cork leaned to the screen.
Jenny, he called. Could I talk to you a moment?
Joe gasped.
Cork, get away from there. That nice kid's hand was on her butt, Cork said.
When he returned to Sam's place, the first thing he did was to head for the basement. Cork shared Sam's place with a monster he called Godzilla, an ancient oil-burning furnace that occupied a good deal of the space beneath the old Quonset hut. Godzilla had a temperamental disposition that generally required giving the burner a kick now and then. Whenever the old furnace rumbled on in the winter, a shudder ran through the pipes above that often gave Cork's visitors a start. He'd hoped to have enough money from the season's profit to replace Godzilla with something new and quiet that burned clean natural gas instead of smelly heating oil. But employing Annie and Jenny all summer had eaten whatever savings he might have put away. Considering how much he'd enjoyed the company of his daughters in those months, he felt it was a trade that was more than fair. Cork pulled the cord on the overhead light and stepped around Godzilla. He went to a black trunk shoved against a wall beneath a couple of shelves of jars. The jars were gifts from Rose. They contained tomato preserves, choke cherry jelly, sweet corn relish, pickled watermelon rind. Despite the fact that Cork was separated from her sister Jo, Rose continued in her own ways to take care of Cork with a vengeance. He opened the trunk. On top lay a rolled bearskin. He lifted the skin, felt the weight of it that was in large part due to the Smith & Wesson 38 Model 10 Military and Police Special wrapped in oilcloth inside. Both the bearskin and the gun were ties to the two most important men in his past. The gun had been his father's when he was sheriff of Tamarack County, and Cork had worn it during his own tenure in that office. The bearskin had been left to him by Sam Wintermoon and was a constant reminder of how the man had saved his life in so many ways after Cork's father was killed. They were violent symbols, to be sure, yet upon the memories they represented rested much of the foundation for Cork's understanding of what it was to be a man. Underneath the rolled bearskin was folded a yellowed wedding dress, his mother's. The trunk, before it had come into his possession, had held mostly his mother's treasures. When, at his wife's insistence, he'd left the house on Gooseberry Lane, the house he'd grown up in, the trunk was one of the few non-essentials he took with him.
He'd failed in so many duties that keeping safe the things his mother had valued was one he wouldn't forsake. Cork lifted the wedding dress and laid it gently on the bearskin. A great deal of the space remaining in the trunk was taken up by boxes of old photographs. When she was alive, his mother was always planning to sort through the photos, organize them, place them in the pages of albums. It never happened. What she left behind was a jumble of lives seen in scattered moments. Cork began to sift through a box. He couldn't remember the last time he'd looked at the collection, and if he hadn't been so focused in his mission, he'd have lingered over photographs, puzzle pieces that formed his history. Yet it took him almost an hour and three boxes to find the photo he was looking for. It was black and white and taken with an old Kodak box camera that Cork remembered well. The photograph showed the O'Connor house on Gooseberry Lane circa 1961. In the front yard, squinting into the sun, wearing calf-length print dresses were his mother's cousin Ellie Grand, and Ellie's 12-year-old daughter, Moray. They'd come that year from the Twin Cities to live in Aurora after Ellie had finally given up trying to live as an urban Indian. No one seemed to know about Moray's father, or if they did, they never spoke of him. For reasons Cork never really knew, Ellie Grand hadn't been welcome on the Iron Lake Reservation, so Cork's mother had offered her sanctuary in the house on Gooseberry Lane. For almost a year, Ellie Grand slept in the guest room and Moray in the sewing room. Moray Grand hadn't been like any girl Cork had known. She reminded him of an East Indian princess. Long black hair, gold dust eyes, soft fine features, and skin a darker hue than that of any Ojibwe he'd ever seen. He loved her immediately. Moray, nearly 3 years older than he, had found him amusing. At first, she called him Ojib, which meant shadow or ghost, for he followed her everywhere. Later, she dubbed him Nishima, little brother. He dug some more in that same box and came up with a shot of Ellie's pie shop, the old house on the edge of town that Cork's mother loaned the money for, and that Ellie Grand turned into an enterprise much favored by the summer tourists. He found a photograph he recalled taking himself at the Wyndham Bluegrass Festival the year Moray took first place. She was 16, beautiful, happy. All the tragedy was still far ahead. Cork was tired by the time he came across several articles clipped together. They'd come from the St. Paul Pioneer Press, and were a series that reported on the murder of Moray Grand at her home in Palm Springs. He skimmed the articles, refreshing his memory. The primary suspect had been a man named Vincent Benedetti, owner of a Vegas casino called the Purple Parrot, and reputed to have had connections with organized crime. In the rumor mill, he'd been linked romantically with Moray. The articles followed the investigation until it was ultimately dropped, officially leaving unanswered the question of who'd killed Moray Grand. Cork carefully placed everything back in the trunk except the early photo of Moray on the front lawn and the bearskin. The photo he slipped into his pocket. The bearskin he held a while, considering the weight of what it concealed. Sam Winter Moon had once told him that all things created by Kitchimanadu, the Great Spirit, had many purposes. A birch tree supplied shelter for animals, bark for canoes, sticks for cooking fires. A lake was a home for fish, water for drinking, a cool place on a hot day. But a gun, what purpose did a gun serve except to kill? Cork put the bearskin back, closed the trunk, and turned away from one more unanswered question. Chapter 5. He was stepping out of the shower 15 minutes later when the phone rang. Cork? Wally Shano? Cork rubbed a towel across his chest. The towel smelled musty, and he made a note to do some wash. Yeah, Wally? What's up?
Can you drop by my office soon? How soon? I haven't had any dinner yet, and I'm starved. Grab a burger. You can eat it here. I eat burgers all day long. What's it about? I'll tell you when I see you. Just get over here. How about a please? Sheriff Wally Shano was quiet on his end of the line. Please, he finally grunted. 20 minutes later, Cork pulled his Bronco into the parking lot of the Tamarack County Sheriff's Department. Inside, the night desk officer, Deputy Marsha Dross, buzzed him through the security door.
They're in the sheriff's office, she said, nodding toward a closed door.
They?
I make them to be FBI, maybe BCA. Poles up their asses for sure.
Any idea what they want?
She shrugged. Search me. But every time the sheriff pokes his head out, he looks like somebody gave his colon another crank.
Cork knocked on the door and opened it when he heard Wally Shano grumble from the other side.
Shano sat at the desk Cork had occupied for almost 8 years himself. Too much time had passed for Cork to feel any antipathy toward the man who'd taken his place.
Shano was about one gray hair shy of retirement anyway. He was a Lutheran, staunch Republican, and not a bad sheriff. A big man, he wore special order shoes, had huge hands with long, crooked fingers. At the moment, he was dressed in a white shirt, gray pants, black suspenders. He looked tired, but he often looked that way. His wife, Arletta, suffered from Alzheimer's, and between his duty to the voters and his duty to his wife, Shano had those huge hands of his more than full. He waved Cork in like an impatient cop directing traffic.
Close the door behind you.
Good evening to you too, Wally, Cork said. Three men were in the office with Shano. Two were black, one white. They wore suits, although a couple of them had their coats off, ties loosened, sleeves rolled back. The windows were closed. The air in the office was warm, a little rank from the sweat of worried men. They'd been huddled in front of a map taped to Shano's wall. When Cork came in, they turned. He felt their eyes go over every inch of him, but their faces registered about as much emotion as if he were nothing but a draft of air. The tallest of the men was the first to move toward Cork and offer his hand.
Mr. O'Connor, Special Agent in Charge Booker T. Harris, FBI. I appreciate your coming.
Like the deep, measured tone of his voice, his handshake was firm and purposeful. A man used to command. His hair was short and for the most part black, although gray had begun to flare along his temples. His skin was light, like maple wood.
Agent Harris, Cork said and nodded.
Harris turned to the nearest of the others, a man whose skin was dark brown with just a hint of red like cinnamon tea.
This is Special Agent Sloan.
Sloan reminded Cork of a linebacker he knew in college, a man low to the ground and solid. But if Sloan had indeed played football, his best games were 30 years behind him. Much of his muscle had gone to fat, although there was still a lot of power visible in his big chest and shoulders. Cork and Agent Sloan exchanged a decent handshake. The man's eyes were a liquid brown and tired. His sleeves were rolled back, and his huge forearms were covered with white scar tissue, like long scratches on mahogany.
And Special Agent Grimes?
Grimes was lean and grinning. He had red-brown hair and a military crew cut. A jawbone sharp as a machete, blue-white eyes like hot steel, a calloused hand. His face carried the tan and sharp creases of a man who spent a lot of time in the sun.
Have a seat, Shano said.
Cork sat down and looked carefully at the map taped to the wall, a topographic map of the boundary waters.
I'll get right to the point, O'Connor, Harris said.
He leaned back easily against Shano's desk in a pose that made the office seem familiar to him, as if the space had very quickly become his personal territory.
The sheriff has assured me you're a man who can be trusted. We've got a problem on our hands, and we're going to need your cooperation.
Go on, Cork said.
Harris reached into a briefcase on the floor, pulled out a folded tabloid newspaper, and handed it to Cork. The major headline read, $10,000 reward. It appeared above a huge color photo of the woman called Shiloh. The photograph was the kind anyone, man or woman, would have begged to have burned. Shiloh's skin was bright and oily, her eyes angry, her face twisted in a snarling remark in the instant the glare of the flash had caught her. She looked positively demented, nothing like the soft CD cover Arkansas Willie Ray had shown him that afternoon. Beneath the photo, the caption read, "Help us find Shiloh and you pocket 10 grand." "It's a gimmick," Harris said. "This rag's been updating the world on Shiloh sightings ever since she dropped out a couple of months ago. New York City, Paris, Santa Fe, Graceland. We have reason to believe this woman is, in fact, somewhere up here, O'Connor."
"What reason?" Cork said. He returned the paper to Harris.
"Good reason," Harris said, and let it drop.
"All right," Cork said. "Assuming she is up here, what do you want with me?"
"We know she was guided into the Boundary Waters canoe aerial wilderness some time ago by an Indian. We need to identify this man so that we can locate her. Sheriff Shano believes you can help us with that." The room was too warm. Cork wanted to tell Wally Shano to open a window, let in some cool evening air, and let out the smell of the worry. "You say she dropped from sight," Cork said.
"Voluntarily?"
"Yes. We've spoken with her publicist and her manager. They both say the move was her choice, but that they don't know anything more. She was apparently very secretive about the whole thing, and very sudden."
"Then why look for her? Seems to me if she wants privacy, she's entitled to it."
"We have our reasons," Harris replied.
"Good reasons," Cork finished for him. He stood as if to leave. "Gentlemen, it's been interesting, but you're on your own."
"This is a federal investigation, O'Connor," Harris warned him.
"So take me to court."
"Look, if you want his help, tell him what's going on," Shano broke in. "Just be straight with him."
Harris gave Shano a sharp look, considering the advice as if it were about as enticing to him as a spoonful of sulfur. His eyes flicked toward the other two agents, and they appeared to have a wordless conference. Harris gave a grudging nod.
"Okay. The Bureau's interest in this case and its jurisdiction comes from the RICO statute. You know what that is?"
"Sure. Racketeer Influenced and Corrupt Organizations Act. How does that tie in with the woman in the Boundary Waters?"
15 years ago, this woman, Shiloh, was the only witness to her mother's murder."
"We all know that," Cork said, and he sat back down. "Her mother was a local."
"Then you probably also know that she's always claimed she couldn't remember what happened that night. Post-traumatic amnesia. Not unheard of. A few months ago, she was ordered by the court to undergo treatment for substance abuse. She's been seeing a psychiatrist named Patricia Sutpen. You may have heard of her. Lots of famous clients. Been on Oprah. Her psychological bag of tricks includes regression therapy. We believe that in the course of her treatment, Shiloh may have finally recalled the events of the night her mother died."
Harris picked up the tabloid from where it lay on top of Shano's desk and slapped it down, hard.
"This piece of trash appeared a couple of weeks ago. Almost immediately, the reporter in charge of the story, if you can call anyone who stoops to this kind of journalism a reporter, gets a call from a woman named Elizabeth Dobson. She's a studio musician for Shiloh. Plays the violin. In country music, they call it a fiddle," Grimes put in quietly and with a grin.
"Whatever."
Harris waved it off and went on. "Elizabeth Dobson claims to have letters from Shiloh. Claims that not only do they tell where she is, but they contain some pretty juicy revelations as well. The reporter arranges to meet her at a restaurant in Santa Monica. She doesn't show. He gets her address from the phone book, goes to her apartment, but gets no answer to his knock. He greases the building manager's palm,
They open her door and find her lying dead on the living room rug, strangled. It appears to be a burglary, lots of stuff missing, including the letters she claims to have had. LAPD, while investigating, stumbles onto a diary Elizabeth Dobson kept right up to the day she died. Entries indicated that Shiloh was somewhere in the Boundary Waters. She was being supplied by a man she referred to only as, Maingun, Agent Sloan said. Cork was surprised at the agent's correct pronunciation. Means wolf in the Ojibwe language, Sloan said. Grimes had taken a pack of juicy fruit from his shirt pocket. He folded several sticks into his mouth. You're a regular encyclopedia, he told Sloan, speaking thickly around the wad of gum. Harris gave them both a sharp look, then addressed Cork again. We're concerned that whoever killed this woman may be after Shiloh. Got any idea who that whoever might be? Cork asked. That's where Rico comes in. The primary suspect in the murder of Murray Grand was a man named Vincent Benedetti. Owns a casino in Las Vegas. The Purple Parrot, Cork said. Yes, Sloan looked surprised. How do you know? Lucky guess. Go on. Harris glanced at Shano, who only looked back blankly. Then the special agent in charge proceeded like a man on a ride he couldn't stop. Before her death, Murray Grand and Benedetti were romantically linked. At the time of the woman's death, Vincent Benedetti was under investigation for racketeering. We've always believed the two events were related. Now Benedetti's nowhere to be found. If Shiloh has remembered what happened that night, we're here to make certain she has the opportunity to testify. Why is it you think I can help? Cork asked. The diary makes it quite clear that Shiloh's somewhere in the Boundary Waters, and that the man who guided her in is an Indian. When we explained the situation fully to Sheriff Shano, he suggested you might be our best hope for identifying this man.
Because I'm part Ojibwe?
And, Harris added pointedly,
because he insists you're smart and can be trusted. Smart? Cork smiled at Shano. You actually said that, Wally?
Well, said Harris, interrupting, can we count on you?
Could I see the diary?
Give him the photocopies, Harris said to Sloan. Sloan lifted an expensive-looking leather attaché case from where it sat on a chair, snapped it open, and took out a folder. He closed the case and carefully put it back down. He crossed to Cork and held out the folder, which was labeled in small, precise block letters, Dobson Diary. The diary entries went back several months. Someone had gone through them already and neatly highlighted in yellow those passages that pertained to Shiloh. Elizabeth Dobson wrote like a romantic. Her script was florid with big loops above the line and elaborate flourishes that ended each sentence. Her writing leaned heavily to the right. Optimistic. The passages that hadn't been highlighted talked about mundane things. Loneliness, whether she should get a cat. Worries, a lot of them, about her mother's health and the cost of caring for her. He found the reference to Maingun, but in his cursory look, found little else that was very helpful.
Before I agree, Cork said, I'd like a few minutes alone with Sheriff Shano.
Harris shook his head.
This is my case. Whatever you've got to say about it, I'd like to hear. Your case. My office, Shano pointed out. If Cork wants to speak with me alone in here, he'll speak with me alone. You gentlemen can wait outside.
Harris chewed on the decision a moment, then jerked his head for the others to follow him. When they stepped outside, Cork closed the door.
Hate these guys, Shano said. Waltz in here like they own the place.
You ID them, he asked.
Yeah, Harris anyway. Why?
Doesn't it seem odd, them showing up here this way, no introduction from the local field office?
I thought the same thing. So I made a call to Arnie Gooden, the field rep in Duluth. I know him, a good man.
He worked in the L.A. office for a while. Said he didn't know anything about this investigation, but he did know Harris. They spoke on the phone a few minutes. Gooden promised to help if Harris needs anything. Look, Cork, you put it all together, it adds up pretty well. If this girl is in the kind of trouble they say, I'd hate to leave her hanging. Cork stood at the window. Across the street, the bell tower of the Zion Lutheran Church was lit with floodlights, blazing white against the dark evening sky. There was something wonderfully simple in the solid colors and the straight lines, and Cork stared a long time. He wondered if he should tell Shano about Arkansas Willie Ray.
Anything else? Shano asked.
I guess not, Cork answered. He opened the door. Only Harris and Sloan came back in.
Well, Harris said.
I'll do what I can, Cork told him. But if I'm going to help, I'll do things my way.
Elaborate, Harris said.
The people I'll be talking to are Ojibwe. They won't trust you. I'll talk to them alone.
I'd prefer one of us accompany you, Harris insisted.
You're strangers, Cork reminded him. More than that, you're federal law. It would be like throwing a skunk at these people.
No offense. If I do this, I have to do it alone.
He's right, Shano said.
Harris crossed his arms, his hands fisted and sheathed in the bends at his elbow. He looked like a man who'd invited himself to dinner, only to discover that the special of the day was a plate full of shit.
All right, he finally agreed, unhappily. Just remember, whoever murdered the Dobson woman may be here now. They could be after Shiloh at this moment. We don't have much time.
In that case, Cork said, I'd best get started.
How do I contact you?
We've got a cabin at a place called the Quetico. Here's the phone number. He wrote it on the back of an FBI business card.
One more thing, O'Connor. We've tried to keep a lid on this, but the tabloid that posted the reward for Shiloh has a front page story on the Dobson death ready to go. By midweek, your little town here is going to be middle ring in a three-ring circus.
I'll keep that in mind, Cork said. He held up the photocopied diary of Elizabeth Dobson. Mind if I hang on to this?
Harris waved him an okay.
We've got other copies. At the desk outside Shano's office, Deputy Marcia Dross handed Cork a brown paper bag.
Fried chicken, she said, and smiled. Sheriff's orders.
Outside the county building, Cork found Grimes waiting for him. The man leaned against Cork's Bronco and watched him approach.
A word of advice, O'Connor,
Grimes said, stepping out to intercept him. Cork held up and waited. Grimes chewed while he talked, moving the wad of juicy fruit around in his mouth like it was chaw.
I've seen local lawmen screw up more times than I care to remember. Working with them is always like trying to dance a ballet in diver's boots. You understand what I'm saying? So what do you say you do us all a favor? Just give us what we ask for and try to stay out of the way the rest of the time. Comprende?
Grimes took the wad of juicy fruit from his mouth and dropped it. Cork stared into his blue-white eyes.
Comprende, he said. Comprende real good.
He nodded down at the gum on the parking lot cement.
Careful there. You might end up stepping in your own mess. Comprende?
He shoved past Grimes, who stood grinning in his wake. Chapter 6. Grand View was a great deal more than just a summer cabin. It was an estate built of yellow pine logs, a huge two-story structure that dominated a southern inlet of Iron Lake called Snowshoe Cove. Moray Grand had had it constructed at the height of her fame, but she'd had little opportunity to use it. Now it was generally rented in season by wealthy families out of the Twin Cities or Chicago. As far as Cork knew, no one connected with Moray Grand had stayed there since her murder. The place was hidden from the highway by an acre of hardwoods, mostly maple. As Cork approached Grand View, the wind ran through the trees, shaking down crimson leaves that fell into his headlights like drops of blood. He knocked at the front door, waited, then knocked again. He checked his watch. A couple of minutes past 7. "Willie?" he called at the curtained front window. "It's Cork O'Connor." He heard an outboard purring on the lake behind Grand View, the sound growing distant. He followed the flagstone walk around to the deck and back. From there, he could see the long stretch of darkness that was Iron Lake at night.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.